in the budget discussion. Now I call upon Honorable Minister of Finance. She is going to reply to the debate. Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, sir. As you in time pointed out, about 48 members have spoken and in fairly great detail. And therefore, I would think it's my honor to be here and respond to many of the observations made by the honorable members. Members have taken very keen interest and have also gone through the details of the budget which is presented, a budget which is for Atmanirbhar Bharat. So it's a budget which clearly draws on the experience, the administrative capacities, and also the exposure that the Prime Minister has had during his long elected tenure, both as Chief Minister and as Prime Minister of this country, known for his commitment towards development, growth, and reform. So these three things are essentially infused in the budget, which is now speaking for itself in the sense it is the instrument through which Atmanirbhar Bharat is to be attained. So post-pandemic and post-global contraction, economies have suffered all over the world, and as I said during my budget speech, the attempt made in this budget is to provide stimulus, provide a strong stimulus, and provide such a stimulus which can bring in that kind of a multiplier effect, and therefore, instead of finding quick short-term solutions, even as we provide short-term quick relief for those people who so desperately need it, we are looking at also medium-term, long-term, sustainable growth, which will keep India in that kind of a growth trajectory, which will maintain us as one of those fastest growing economies in the world. So, government has heard views, opinions, suggestions from experts, from various policy makers around in the country, economists from several parts of the country and also some from outside, and then placed all the thoughts together to produce this budget, which has been tabled in the House. Building an Atmanirbhar Bharat actually reflects the aspiration of the people of India, 130 crore people of India, many of whom, two-thirds of whom, are youth who are looking for opportunities, looking for dignified ways in which they can live their lives, contribute towards building of this country, and therefore are looking not merely for just assistance from government, but also facilitation and building of such ecosystems with which they can contribute to the economy. So the stimulus is for revival and systemic reforms that even during the pandemic that the Prime Minister has taken up. And those reforms are the ones which are going to sustain the growth, sustain ease of doing business, and sustain India as the leader in terms of entrepreneurial skills. And therefore, the blend of looking at stimulus provision and also not losing out on the opportunity that we can derive, even though we are living in a pandemic situation, to reform and make India a better managed, better governed country for our youth. So the relief and succor which was so required for our poor, for those people who were very much outside of their villages, outside of their states, was so distinctly provided. I think many of us have observed it, many of them have been repeated, but it is worth mentioning just once that 800 million people were provided free food grains, free cooking gas were provided for 80 million people, and cash directly was given to 400 million people, farmers, women, Divyang, and also the poor and needy. So an immediate response as soon as the lockdown was announced has actually provided that so much required succor, which is absolutely necessary to support our citizens. The PM Garib Kalyan is valued at 2.76 lakh crores, which is a timely measure that was necessary to be taken. Now, even before I get into some of the details which many of the members of honourable members have raised as issues, saying, can we have a bit of clarity? Will it assure some kind of a steps and so on? I just want to straight away address one issue, sir. Chairman, sir, it's now become a sort of habit for some in the opposition to constantly allege whatever this government is doing in spite of all that we're doing for the poor, and more needs to be done, and that is not denied at all. In spite of the various steps, obviously seen steps taken for helping the poor and needy of this country, a false narrative is created to accuse, saying, oh, this government works only for cronies. I just want to come up with some details before I get into some of the details in the budget to say, houses completed under PM Awas Yojana, sir, more than 1.67 crore houses have been completed. Is that for the rich? Households which have been electrified under Saubhagya since 2017 October is more than 2.67 crores. Is that for the rich? Total value of orders placed on government e-marketplace is 8,22,077 crore, which is more than 8 trillion of rupees. Are they being given to big companies? They are being given to MSMEs. So we have helped out small and medium companies to ensure themselves getting a market. Is that for the rich and the big capitalists? Length of the road sanctioned under Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana is, and that is strictly between 2014-15 and those years, 2,11,192 kilometers. Those roads go to villages. Are they villages only for the rich, or are they villages where people who belong to the lower sections of the society also live? Are they villages where Garib don't live? So whose lifeline are these roads? So unthinkingly just keep throwing allegations, saying, oh, this is for crony capitalists, this government is working only for the rich. Please answer these questions. Total verified applications on National Scholarship Portal, more than 9 crore people, and all of whom are getting fellowships. For whom are these fellowships going? Are they going for the rich? Are they going for the capitalists? Are they going for the cronies who the UPA government had happily encouraged? And now to stand up and each time create a false narrative. Before I get into the details of the budget, I want these questions to be kept in mind much before false narratives are thrown at us. Number of farmers registered on eNAM, sir, approximately 1.69. eNAM was thanks entirely due to the Prime Minister's effort to make sure that the farmers are connected all over the country, and he's not constricted by the local markets. If he has opportunities better anywhere else, he should have it. Are these farmers rich corporate farmers? No, not at all. They are the small farmers. Number of digital transactions, sir, via UPI from August 2016 till January 2020. More than 3.6 lakh crores UPI is used by who? The rich? The corporate? No, not at all. The middle class, the smaller traders, all of them use UPI. So who are these people then? Is this government creating UPI, facilitating digital transactions to benefit some rich cronies, some damads? Not at all. It is helping only the poor. Number of farmers registered, sir, under PM Fasal Bima Yojana, almost 9 crore farmers. Farmers who benefit out of Fasal Bima Yojana are not large corporate farmers. So when you allege us, saying you're not taking care of small and medium-sized farmers, Prime Minister, while standing and speaking in response to the debate on presidential address, spoke extensively about small farmers. And I want to remind you of this number, which is the number which benefits from PM Fasal Bima Yojana. For whom is that? Loans sanctioned under Mudra Yojana. More than 27,000 crores have gone under the Mudra Yojana. Who takes Mudra Yojana? Damads? Therefore, please, don't you allege us much before. Sir.
Please. किसी का नाम लिया नहीं उन्होंने अननेसेसरी आप क्यों फोर्स करते
सर दामाद आई डिडंट थिंक आई हैव अ ट्रेड बैक ऑफ द इंडियन नेशनल कांग्रेस
प्लीज
दामाद
नो
हर घर में होता है
दिग्विजय सिंह जी इट इज नॉट गोइंग ऑन रिकॉर्ड वी आर वेस्टिंग योर एनर्जी
स्पेशलाइज्ड नाम है
नो नो लेट इज नॉट बी डिस्टर्बड अबाउट दामाद
परिवार
लेट अस गो अप विद आवर डिस्ट्रिक्ट प्लीज अरे आपका रिकॉर्ड में नहीं जा रहे आपका वोकल कार्ड खराब हो जाएगा प्लीज
थैंक यू सर सर टोटल नंबर ऑफ बेनिफिशियरीज अंडर पीएम किसान सम्मान निधि योजना 6,000 रुपीज डायरेक्टली थ्रू द डायरेक्ट बेनिफिट ट्रांसफर टू स्मॉल एंड मीडियम साइज फार्मर्स 11 करोड़ फार्मर्स हैव रिसीव्ड पीएम किसान सम्मान निधि योजना आई कैन गो ऑन लाइक दिस टू से इनफ एंड मोर एविडेंस एग्जिस्ट On, no, it's not enough. You don't have the patience to hear more.
No, he's satisfied, ma'am. You continue.
Sir, yes, sir.
He's saying he's satisfied.
Sometimes running commentaries are useful to remind, sir.
Yeah. Don't worry.
So, this government's efforts with credible proof of who the beneficiaries are, which are the major schemes, and therefore when the budgetary provisions are made, it is made for the poor, Dalits, tribals, and the students who need desperately all the benefits. And therefore, if you want to speak out, Ujjwala Yojana benefited how many women? And we've extended it to 1 crore women for whom that Ujjwala will be delivered. Delivery and performance in terms of the last mile connectivity is where we have distinctly shown even some instruments which you have created, even if it's MNREGA. I'll give you the data to prove how. No, no, you don't need to thank me, but you'll have to answer some questions. Where MNREGA has greater provisions in actual numbers during our time, and effectively using it, I will give you data in a minute. So therefore, stimulus and giving stimulus to such an expenditure, the capital creating expenditure, creating infrastructure, is one of the main features of this budget, especially that it is coming after a pandemic. The other, as I said earlier, not losing out on this opportunity of the pandemic, continuing with reforms. Well, and that is governed by the principle which Prime Minister spoke about even in 2014. In fact, deriving from that, one of the leading newspapers, which I wouldn't think will ever support disinvestment, has written an editorial, sir, to say, belated but bold. And belated because Prime Minister had assured in 2014 that he will ensure that disinvestment process will happen. And to have a policy coming in 2021, the paper rightly says belated, but calls it bold. Two, and we shall show how minimum government and maximum governance will be achieved, fiscal reforms with a clear trajectory of showing how the deficit is going to be managed, and above all, something which I think will be reminded over and over again is bringing transparency in government's accounts, accounting for everything that which is there, Unlike, and I shall pick it up from the speech of the former finance minister, figures are suspect in this budget. I'll give you 3 concrete evidence, sir, of how accounts were suspect. I'm not using that word. I'm not certainly using that word. But it became suspect. With the benefit of hindsight, I can give you clear proof of how data became suspect in times which were not under the leadership of Prime Minister Modi. We have brought everything on to the budgetary accounting mechanism. What you get as budget is what is there in it. No pushing things under the carpet. So these are essentially the features, sir, I want to highlight in this budget, and many members have duly recognized it. I'm very grateful that members have recognized that the budget has come out boldly on many things, clearly stated openly what the government's position is, and therefore admittedly the fiscal deficit number is what it is. And we have not even hurried to, you know, say, okay, tomorrow, next year, we will quickly get the deficit number to be something which all of us will like to see. Not at all. We are going to be careful about how we are going to come down that path without affecting or creating any hurdle in this growth path of this country. So on the one word on the disinvestment policy, sir, disinvestment of CPSE policy. As I said, obviously, a newspaper edit, and many newspapers have also said that it is bold. And some newspapers also felt ideologically it's forthright. I wish to say one line here. Repeatedly we hear how 1991 and the reforms of the 1991 were very important. Yes, they were very important. There's no doubt about it. But then the entire range which the Congress Party covered, from high socialism, hybrid socialism with Indira Gandhiji's Congress also reaching a level of socialism which was nothing but licensed Kota Raj. And from there to 91, without blinking an eyelid, without even saying, now we are opening up the economy, they moved from that high socialism to come down to opening globalization and everything else. And today, when we are very clearly coming out, it is a position which is consistent with BJP and Jan Sangh's ideology of take care of the people at the bottom of the rung, Antyodaya. At the same time, respect wealth creators, respect taxpayers. Honest citizens will have to be respected. And that certainly is in line with and is very consistent with the policy which our earlier version, the Jan Sangh, the BJP, all of which have maintained continuously that entrepreneurs in India have always shown their strength and achieved such glories, and we should respect them rather than constrict them through all kinds of holding and regulations and providing of license. So therefore, the route in which we have gone in order to achieve the stimulus is to fund infrastructure both in several areas like rail, road, bridges, ports and waterways, agricultural infrastructure and health infrastructure. Of course, it was rightly pointed out that I didn't mention about defense. However, the allocations for defense, whether you look at pensions, whether you look at capital expenditure, whether you look at revenue, have not come down. Data will certainly show you that in pensions between last year and this year, there's definitely a lesser number being shown, because last year, post the ORoP introduction, there were a lot of arrears which had to be cleared, some because they were queries, some because they were court-related. So obviously the number was much higher than when it is stabilized now. But on all three counts, if you account for that little arrears, we have only increased. In fact, 18.8%, if I'm right, I will show you the figures, has gone up in terms of capital expenditure for defense. So reforms I did mention, and also this license quota Raj, how we have clearly moved away from that. Now, I will go item by item on heads on which several people have asked questions. Honorable members have asked questions on health, defense, and so on. I'm not responding one by one, taking the name of honorable members, but by topic, I'm responding and hope to cover the issues raised by honorable members each by their own during their speech. So on health, it was felt that by bringing drinking water and sanitation into health, we are probably not showing the entire picture, and probably health, the core health, which is known as, you know, Department of Health and Family Welfare's budget, has come down. If I compare just the BE to BE, that's not true. However, I would like to bring in WHO, whose observation justify bringing in water and sanitation into the debate. Sir, WHO mentions, and I quote here, safe drinking water, sanitation and hygiene are crucial to human health and well-being. That is WASH, WASH. Safe and sufficient WASH plays a key role in preventing numerous neglected tropical diseases, such as trachoma, soil-transmitted helminthus, and schistosomiasis. Diarrheal health as a result of inadequate WASH were reduced by half during the Millennium Development Goals, and that is the period of 1990 to 2015. With the significant progress on water and sanitation provision playing a key role. So increased allocations, unquote, increased allocations for water have been based on the objective to provide tap water to ensure health for all in the long run. So even if we just look at the allocations made to the core health departments, there is a substantial increase in their allocations. I'll just read out three heads on which that can be proved. Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. BE in 2020-21, sir, was 65,012 crores. BE 21-22, 71,269, which is a 9.6% increase. That's core. Ministry of AYUSH, which is again core health, 2,122 in 2020-21, which went up to 2,970 this budget, which is a 40% increase in AYUSH ministry. So then the highest allocation between all these three goes for health research, 2,100 in 2020-2021, whereas it went up to 2,663 in this budget, constituting a 26.8% increase. Just these three, which are normally seen as core departments of health and not bringing in water, not bringing in sanitation, you have 9.6, 40%, and 26.8% for the three categories. So let us not be carried away by this debate of, oh, you brought in health here, you brought in water and sanitation here, you brought in portion here. The core three for which everybody looks up for figures, we have increase, increase, and increase. So that's about the health, sir. Defense. I did mention a minute ago on defense expenditure. It's easy always to club it all together and say defense expenditure is this, is that. We will have to, yes, I'm coming to it. We will have to divide it into three compartments. The revenue, capital, and pensions. Sir, just to give you a comparison, 2011-12, 2012-13 are figures which I'll read first. 12-13, before that 11-12, revenue 95,216 crores. Capital 11-12, 69,199 crores. Pensions 34,000 crore, and this is for 11-12. We'll move to 12-13, sir. Revenue, capital, and pension in that order. 1,13,829 revenue. Capital, 79,579. And pensions, 39,000. I don't want to go year by year. Come straight to the year which is ending now, 2020-2021. Where it was 95,216 in 11-12, sir, it is 2,09,319 in the year which is ending, just on revenue count. And where in 11-12, for capital, it was 69,199. It is now 1,13,734 under capital. And where under pensions in 11-12, it was 34,000. Now it is 1,33,825 for pensions. If that last year revenue, capital and pension grew at 3.7%, 10% and 19.4%. Now I come to this year's allocation. 21-22, revenue, sir, 2,12,028, which is 1.3% more than BE of last year. BE to BE comparison, no mixing up. Capital, sir, 1,35,061, which is an 18.8% increase this budget. Pension, sir, 1,15,850, which is a fall from last year. As I said, last year's number had a huge addition because of arrears, because of court cases or queries on pension arrears which were being paid, which is one time, and that got rationalized now. But even then, it is much higher than 2019-20. So every count, even defense budget, is higher, although you would tell me that in your speech you didn't mention defense at all. Here's the figure. It is available in the appendix of the speech. It's available in the documents of government expenditure. So then, PM Kisan Samman, I think I broadly have given figure. 10,000 has become reduced. I wish honorable members who have raised that question, I'm glad they've raised it and have given me an opportunity to answer, but members who have raised that, I wish they had had a look at actually what is the figure. Sir, benefits worth 1.15 lakh crores have been transferred into the bank accounts of 10.75 crore farmer families under this scheme since its inception. Let's be clear, 1.15 lakh crores directly into the accounts of the farmers. Cash in the hands of the people is what is 1.15 lakh crores to the hands of the farmers. Now, BE 2019-20 and BE 2020-21, the allocation of 75,000 crores each year was made under the scheme. In RE 2020-21, the allocation has been rationalized to 65,000 crores, which is what is being pointed out to us, saying 10,000 crores you cut down. Not at all. A similar allocation is also provided in 21-22. But I will tell you why the rationalization has had to happen. Sir, one of the main reasons for rationalization to happen is in the allocation of PM Kisan scheme, and that is approximately 69 lakh estimated farmers from West Bengal have not received any benefits under the scheme. So we had taken them on board, but when the provision cannot be utilized because their list was not even given to us, Obviously, in the RE, the number will be different, and the provisioning that we'll have to make for the next year will also be dependent on it. We took the entire country. We wanted every state's farmers to receive. But if there is one state which refuses to give their list, and therefore the amount remains, and therefore the amount which has to be given to them in the BE next, given to all the farmers in the BE next, will be reflective of that number which is not coming on board. So 10,000 is not going anywhere else, sir. It is because one state has not given us the list. So that is on the key PM Kisan, where you felt that the numbers are different. So I would want to go on to a very important issue, which pertains to what have we done about people who have been thrown out of their jobs, what is happening to MNREGA, and so on. I'll first go to the MNREGA bit. So year on year, the enthusiasm with which particularly members in the opposition belonging to a particular party own it all up. MNREGA is ours. Don't you claim any credit on that. MNREGA is ours. You don't talk about it. MNREGA, because we, oh my God, I want to, to give birth to a scheme is yours, no doubt. But the mess and the way it was poorly utilized, leading to even CAG's paragraph as to how people did not, who should get it, got it. They don't even have the actual numbers of farmers or people who enrolled on demand workers. So I'll give you, therefore, the first submission, Honorable Chairman, sir, is we create a scheme, we give BEs, but every year we have utilized far lesser than the BE. That's our credibility about MNREGA, but we want to speak about it with ownership. Whereas what we have done after Prime Minister Modi taking charge in 2014 to remove all the ills out of that scheme, yes, to remove all the, you know, and effectively utilize it, which data proves. No point in heckling. No point in heckling, sir, worry. Because the data proves.
Not going on record. Heckling.
And I seek your indulgence, Chairman, sir. I seek your indulgence, Chairman, sir, because I will give numbers.
Go ahead.
Sir, 2009-10, BE was 39,100. RE was also 39,100, but actual number was spent was only 33,539. Now, similarly, 10, 11, 12, I'll read the numbers. 4100 BE, 4100 RE, but actually 35,841 down. 40, again, down to 29 in 11, 12. 12, 13, 33, down to 30. 13, 14, 33, down to 32. Then 14, 15, 34, down to 32. Every year, lesser and lesser and lesser. BE, you claim that you've given that much, and actually no utilization happens. All right? Sir, 15, 16, after our government comes, 34, is 37 in actual utilization. 38 in 16-17 is 48 in actual utilization. 17-18, 48 becomes 55 in actual utilization. 18-19, 55 becomes 61 in actual utilization. And 19-20, 60,000 becomes 71,000 actual utilization. 2021, which is the year of the pandemic, sir, 61,500 is what we gave prior to the COVID coming in February 2020 budget. 61, which was 1,500 more than the BE of the previous year. But because during the COVID period, we had to come in with greater help, we went on giving it through the supplementary demands and so on, 1,11,500. And as of now, the actual utilization is 90,469, highest ever. And without hesitation, we kept giving, proving our track record that the BE could be something, but actually we also provide for more of it. Whereas you gave BEs, and end of the day, you forgot it. Whatever little what was BEs. Utilized, what you was utilized, which was far lesser than your BE. So your track record is that, not just 1 year, 2 years. Your track record is BE provision. End of the day, utilization is God knows anybody's number. Never, never, never your BE was met. So higher BE to BE. Now coming to this year's provision. 61,500 was February 20, just prior to COVID. Now 73,000 crores is given in this BE. In this BE, which is higher than the BE last year, having in between provided during the pandemic for MGNREGA. So I want on MGNREGA, less emotional, but more factual debate. Ownership alone doesn't come in, but come talk the details, talk the facts. So, MGNREGA, you have not done anything on MGNREGA. This is what you've done on MGNREGA. Sir, also this question about what have you done in terms of, you know, unemployment? I want to just very quickly list out the things that we've done for the unemployment. Yes, a lot of people suffered during pandemic, but immediately after the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana was announced, we came up with the Garib Kalyan Yojana, within which we provided for the employees to draw money from their accounts. But sooner, we also said both 12% employee share and the employer share will be provided if employees with a certain number of total number of employees would take up the job, those who were being dispensed with. And for that, 2,567 crores have been credited upfront into the EPF accounts. So it's not a promise we gave and we sat back. We actually gave that amount towards 12 plus 12 of the PF amounts which have to be given, and that money went to 38.82 lakh eligible employees' accounts. And this is what I want you all to please know. And this has gone to 2.63 lakh establishments, sir. Other than this, we've also come up with the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Rozgar Yojana, which is partly what I covered under the MGNREGA. Nearly 116 districts which received migrant laborers back. They are spread over six states. Nearly 50,000 crores were paid through that particular scheme for migrant workers who went back to their respective districts so that they don't reach home and have no employment. Some kind of money will have to be paid. 50,000 crores has been given to them. Sir, PM Swarnidhi Yojana. 50 lakh street vendors have benefited, and 10,000 rupees have been given for each one of them for a 1 year tenure as working capital. Then Agricultural Infrastructure Fund for the farm gate also generates a lot of income generating activities. That is very important. We have to take cognizance of that. And then we came up with the Atmanirbhar package, even in which several such extension, particularly the one which was last announced, was when employees take back. And that is, that provision exists for all, for all workers who were thrown out of their jobs between one minute, I'll just give you the date. 1st March 2020 till 30th September 2020, everyone who has been sent out of their jobs, if the employer takes them back, we have agreed to pay the employee's contribution for the next 2 years, and that will be up to 31st May 2023. And as it is, a lot of people have started enrolling in it. 1.46 lakh establishment are already registered. 7,75,000 people are new joinees, And those who are coming back to the same job are 1,78,369 as of 1st February. We'll need to continuously keep updating these figures. So that is about MNREGA, that's about unemployment. A lot of people questioned us about what have you done on MSMEs. I can very quickly tell you,
Narmaraji, one second. We're giving elaborate break, no problem. But only thing is we have to conclude by 3 o'clock. I'm equally concerned about the health of the members. The Lok Sabha is meeting at 4 o'clock. So, health of the economy. If people are there, economy will be there. If economy is there, people will be there. That's what she is explaining also.
Sir, I'll just elaborate a bit on the MSMEs. I'll probably even, if necessary, answer members on COVID-related measures, which I wanted to elaborate on. But a bit of the conclusion also. I hope to finish, sir, in reasonable time.
Right.
Sir, in 2019, there was this UK SINA committee which had submitted a lot of recommendations for helping the MSME. We have, since 2019, taking up a lot of steps so that MSMEs get all kinds of assistance. In different levels of stress that they may be, we still wanted to help them. So there was a Self-Reliant India Fund, which was given some money, with which 5 times more monies were to be raised by daughter funds, which will come out of the 10,000 crores which were given as anchor money, and the National Small Industries Corporation Limited was to execute it, and they are executing it. An initial 500 crore has been allocated for this year and the next, and therefore we expect that to go on helping out on small and medium units. During the pandemic, you are aware that we came up with an emergency credit guarantee liquidity scheme. As of 10th February, it was a scheme for 3 lakh crores, sir. And as of 10th February, 91 lakh borrowers, all MSMEs, have benefited from that scheme. And total sanctioned amount is 2,43,440 crores, of which 1,78,000 crores have already been disbursed. So that's money actually going in the hands of MSMEs who wanted additional working capital without any additional security being asked. Existing security people got additional working capital, and to the extent of 1,78,000 crores have been given to them. So a subordinate debt scheme was also brought in, wherein stressed, almost on the verge of NPA kind of MSMEs also could borrow in the name of their promoters, who took equity and who borrowed money and then put it as an equity into their businesses and thereby raised the company out of the stress situation and became eligible for other benefits which banks could extend. 4,000 crores was given as corpus for this, and MSMEs which are completely stressed have also benefited from that scheme. Besides that, a lot of other smaller schemes and definitional changes in MSMEs have helped many of the MSMEs to come out of the difficulty. I wouldn't want to go on elaborating. It's available in records for people to see it. Sir, developmental sector. There was this feeling that development sector allocations have not really been kept up with because you've been constantly talking only of funding capex. That's not true, sir. I want to tell you very quickly in terms of numbers. Department of Health and Family Welfare, total of, I've given you the disaggregated figures, 21.3% increase. Health, Ayush, Health Research, 93.4%. Comparing with in the RE of 2021, following important changes important departments, apart from subsidy departments, has seen substantive growth in their allocation. And I just wanted to read that out. Pharmaceuticals have had 41%, rural development 64.3%, railways 54%, labour and employment 13.7%, defence capital, I told you, 18.3%, DFS is 131%, and DPIIT 14.8%. Sir, you also are aware that we've taken a lot of steps during the COVID so that companies don't come under stress. We've suspended the IBC implementation. We've also given a lot of relief through the debt recovery tribunals and so on. A lot of clauses have been held back so that companies are not pulled into insolvency or any kind of litigation. I will stop short of going into details there, but coming towards the conclusion, since you told me that everything has got to get over by 3 o'clock, sir.
I feel sorry, but what can I do?
No, I understand, sir. I just want to highlight that this budget is a budget for Atmanirbhar Bharat. We respect honest taxpayers. We respect honest taxpayers that their money, which is paid as tax, should be properly utilized. We should be accountable for the money that we get as tax. And therefore, we came up very clearly, to show every money which has been spent on the budget itself rather than keep it outside. A classic case is the onboarding of food subsidy and the impact on the FCI balance sheet. We've onboarded food subsidy budget and therefore also then cleared the loans which were due to the NSSF. I just want to elaborate on that because it has a very serious and important positive implication, sir. The balance sheet of FCI has improved, and that is so important for MSP-based procurements. It is so important for keeping the health of FCI very good because it's important for our food security. Their outstanding loans from NSSF, the National Savings Scheme, are estimated to be reduced from 3.39 lakh crores to 1.19 lakh crore by the end of the current financial year and only 0.58 lakh crore by the end of the next financial year. Completely, government has been responsible and careful to repay the debts which are taken by FCI from the NSSF. Additionally, we have provided an amount of 2,500 crores as capital infusion into the FCI and therefore keeping them healthy to continue with their procurement and storage operations. This will strengthen the financial position of FCI, reduce the debt servicing cost of FCI, which is ultimately borne by the Government of India. So if that is one thing, I just want to, because it's important. Refer to the speech of the former finance minister who responded to the budget of this year. He says, I'm quoting from his speech, major numbers are suspect in this budget. Major numbers are suspect in this budget. I just want to highlight three instances, sir, where there was an artificial increase in the CAPEX figure, CAPEX growth, shown in 2007-08, when the former finance minister was the finance minister. 62% was shown, BE to BE, as increase in 2007-08 budget. And actually, now, with the benefit of hindsight, all of us can say, suspect indeed. 62% increase, sir. 62%. Ma'am, I will definitely explain why I say that. In 2007-08, the jump in the capital expenditure is on account of a routing exercise, routing entry.
Please.
Which was made, 40,000 crores was made. 40,000 crores was made for acquiring RBI's stake in SBI, which was actually a fiscally neutral transaction designed for whatever reason at that time. Actually, 62%, if actually, is offset for this 40,000 crores, which was a fiscally neutral transaction, and if you strip that off, the growth rate in capex that year was only 9%, sir. If that is not suspect, that 62% which was claimed is not suspect, then to say that was the highest ever capex spent, not at all. 34.5%, which we've done now, is the highest ever, sir, capex. And that capex, sir, is getting split between railways at 53%, road 32%, and 18.7%, which is said for defense capex. That's what is honest statement. And the FCI onboarding in the budget is an honest statement. These are not suspect. A former finance minister, and I take every word of what he said seriously, sir. And yes, and therefore I'm telling you, that was wrong statement to make. We have come up with onboarding on factual matters, and we've not shown this kind of fiscal neutral routing as claim for capex expenditure. This is the actual figure. Second, sir, special bonds were issued in lieu of cash subsidy, which is absolutely something which all of us will be shocked by, but it is worth stating it for the records. Special bonds worth 1.7 lakh crores to oil marketing companies in lieu of cash subsidy. The issuance started in 97-98. Oil Minister, Petroleum Minister is here, and he would know also the details. When oil bonds to the tune of 12,984 crores were issued, again, special bonds worth 27,500 crores to fertilizer companies. Show it on your budget. Why didn't you do that? And our numbers are suspect when you have done this. Special bonds worth 27,500 crores to fertilizer companies in lieu of cash subsidy beginning 2007-08. This is not our practice, sir. Again, special bonds worth 16,200 crores to FCI, that FCI which we are now paying back all their loans and getting them on board in the budget. Special bonds worth 16,200 crores to FCI in lieu of cash subsidy beginning 2006-07. And then, if my balance sheet looks very attractive, you know why. Third, sir, I just want to, I'll quickly finish it, sir. The last one, which I remember Sri Arun Jaitley, after taking charge as finance minister in 2014, had to pay up and clean up, is oil companies were asked to foot the petroleum subsidy bill. Oil companies were asked to do it. And when we come back after the vote on account in July of that year, it was realized in 2014-15, an amount of 63,427 crore was artificially kept at the time of interim budget. In 2014-15 July budget, Sri Arun Jaitley, after NDA came to power, realized that there was an under-provisioning. Now, that word is very important because we've been alerted. Quite a few under-provisioning has happened. You should take care. Former finance minister. Under-provisioning during his time, madam, 2014 budget in July. Yes, Chairman, sir, because there was a reference by one of the members. No, a madam's running commentary has to be drawn.
Please, you don't worry, there are madams also sitting that side. Madam is looking to madam. Don't worry.
A running commentary, sir, by a madam will have to be
Please.
Drawn.
Please, you don't worry, sir.
2014-15.
You don't worry. You don't worry about me. You worry about yourself.
Sir, I'm concluding, sir.
Right, ma.
2014-15.
They are very much concerned about the chair. That's the
2014-15 in July budget, the NDA government realized that there was under-provisioning and the oil marketing companies were being asked to foot the subsidy bill. And interestingly on that, sir, whether that and earlier also, the kind of expressions which were used. Anyway, I don't want to take your time.
Right, ma'am, please.
The then of FM corrected that, which was pushed onto the balance sheet of the oil marketing companies. And that is what makes budget suspect for the common citizen, not what we have done this year. Sir, in order to conclude, I just want to say, false narratives were created. Yeah, yeah, competent also to fudge, keep fudging, maybe. His competency, and I don't want that competency. Prime Minister Modi does not depend on fudging, and competency doesn't arise out of that. Sir, there is a lot of grudge in the speech of the former finance minister. I just want to say this to you, sir, because I'll read those little sentences just for the context, sir. Under-provisioning was a reference made, and I've explained that. I have complimented you in writing, and I compliment you here in one place. Another place, sir, while I have given you half a compliment, I have to hold back the other half of the compliment. Second place, sir. Third place, sir, quoting Dr. Geeta Gopinath, who said it's mechanical, you know, growth happens and all that, says, so don't claim credit for that growth. It's also a little assertion by the former finance minister, sir. I'm quoting from his speech. Sir, so when I feel that there is a little grudge not to recognize how Honorable Prime Minister handled the corona crisis, today the entire world is seeing how we in India have had less deaths per million. We in India have less active cases when there are countries which are seeing wave after wave. And this handling is entirely due to the coming up front and being leading from the front by the Prime Minister, and the common people of India had common cause with the way he was dealing with it as a result. Sir, I need to just say this one last sentence, sir.
Please.
The former...
Please. You are not making speech. It's not going on record.
Former
please.
Finance Minister...
You had your speeches. She is replying. Sir. She is replying. Apply sir. Your mind to the reply and keep it to future discussion in the
sir.
Countries.
You have just given me the context to say something, sir. Please pardon me if I'm taking it a bit light. I wouldn't mind. I'll seek your indulgence, sir. The former finance minister gives me a feeling that he is trying to imitate you.
He spoke, and she has to respond.
Sir, I get the feeling the former finance minister is imitating you, sir. But he has been a miserable failure in the impact that he created, unlike you, who creates a good impact. I'll tell you why, sir. The imitation and the copy of the chair in coming up with rhyming words, text, pretext, subtext, context. He used all this trying to imitate you, sir, who spontaneously does it, and you have a sense of timing. All of us rejoice in that kind of a, you know, banter and light-hearted way in which you use the rhyming words. It brings a different sense in the house. Trying to imitate it and having absolutely no impact absolutely proves that it is a contrived speech which had nothing to accuse this budget of.
Right,
but yes, verbose, you know, craftsmen of words, we can say what we want and get away with it. I even at the beginning said it's a budget by the rich, of the rich, was a statement given by the former finance minister. I explained right at the beginning, roads, Ujjwala, electricity, and also direct benefit transfer doesn't go to the rich, it goes to the poorest of the poor, whose cause the Prime Minister champions. Therefore, sir, I think the opposition's questions, doubts, I've tried attempting giving them a response. I quite welcome any member who wants any further clarification.
Thank you.
But thank you for this opportunity.
Please, time is very less.
May I just seek a clarification?
Please.
The first thing, I want to congratulate the Finance Minister for at least accepting the fact that we want to make India Atmanirbhar, not yet Atmanirbhar. And I'm very happy that she has accepted that. The clarification I want is
that
you have reduced the allocation. It is the Kisan who is hurt and the Kisan who is sitting there. And you have reduced the allocation, and I want to ask you, why have you reduced the allocations for agriculture?
Right.
Sure. As far as the...
Right, everybody.
No, one second.
Please.
You have also reduced the allocations to education. Please clarify to the House as to why you have reduced the allocations for agriculture and allocations for agriculture and one other thing.
You had promised the defense personnel. I have previous instance also.
Every five years you will increase the pension for defense personnel. Why did you not increase the pension this year?
Right. Clarification. Clarification. Please. Anybody else? You want to respond? Please. Please. Huh? What is the clarification? 1 minute more.
One clarification. Ma'am. The allocation for MIS PSS for 21-22 was 1,500 crores. It fell 25% from 2021 and was half of 2019-20. Allocation under PM.
What is the clarification?
Allocation for the most important funds meant for the MSP is reduced. Why?
Right. Please.
Sir, with due respect, sir, Honourable Member Sibyl G asked me about the education allocation. Actually, it's not reduced, sir. Total allocation for Department of School Education and Department of Higher Education is 93,224 crores in 21-22, which is 4.2% higher than the actual expenditure of 19-20 and 9.6% more than the current RE. That I want to explain, sir. And similarly, under National Program for Midday Meals in Schools, the allocation in BE of 21-22 is 11,500 crores, which is higher than the BE of 2021 by about 11,000 crores. So it's actually not reduced.
Right.
And defense, I did explain that defense is now under no category have we reduced. On the contrary, we have only increased. But increasing of the pension is not just Government of India. It will have to have a whole lot of exercise. It's not a,
right.
It's not something which over within
Mr.
1 year
Mr.
I can deal with.
Sir?
MSP.
Sir, that is... Oh, I'm sorry. Honourable Member Biswam, sir, through you I want to tell you. Agriculture MSP reduction? I have read out even during the budget speech as to how much of procurement under MSP for each one of those. And 22 crops are listed and all 22 we are opening up for MSP procurement.
Right.
And where is this imaginary, you've reduced? This
right,
is why I humbly submit, sir, to you, through you, I appeal to members, fake narratives, please do not buy it. Have a look at the budget. Actual numbers are there.
Right, ma'am. Thank you. Honourable members, the two-week-long first part of this budget session concluded today. I am happy to inform you that this part of the session has been quite productive, with the House clocking 99% productivity. House The productivity of the House during this week has been 113%, as against the productivity of 82% during the first week, as against the total scheduled time of 45 hours, 4 minutes, net of only 30 minutes have been lost due to disruptions. This part of the session has been one of the debate and discussions with a total of 27 hours and 11 minutes, accounting for over 60% of the total functional time spent on discussing motion of thanks to the President and the General Budget for 21-22. About 100 members spoke on these two subjects alone, as against the total loss of 4 hours 24 minutes during the first week. The members sat for an extra 3 hours 54 minutes during the second week. A total of 88 issues of public importance have been raised. Those include 56 jura ova and 32 special mentions. 55 starred questions were orally answered. 3 bills were passed: the J&K Reorganization Amendment Bill 2000, the National Capital Territory of Delhi Law Special Provisions Amendment Bill 2021, and the Major Ports Authority Bill 2020. This is the position as of now. We still have to go for the second part. I only appeal to the members not to miss any standing committee meetings. Please see to it that you attend all the standing committee meetings and make contribution also. I feel sorry to miss you, Ajaji, Mohammed Fayaz, Samshir Singh Manhas, and also Nazir Ahmed Ravek. I wish you all the best, as I've said earlier. And with this, we'll be concluding this part of the session. The House stands adjourned till 9 a.m. on Monday, the 8th March 2021.